Let's get right to MSNBC climate reporter Moses Small and hurricane specialist and WTVJ meteorologist John Morales. So Moses, we just got an update, I understand. What's the latest on the storm's strength and its path?
Yeah, Ana, we got an update from the National Hurricane Center literally probably 2 minutes ago. The storm is still Category 2, wind speed 100 miles per hour. But now the center of that storm is now offshore from Cuba and heading towards the Bahamas. It made landfall in southeastern Cuba at about 3 this morning Eastern time. And it is still a dangerous storm. It's still powerful. But I want to take a look at the track. You'll notice a couple things here that as this gradually makes its way northeast, is going to remain a hurricane all the way through at least Friday afternoon. But it's also moving a lot faster. Yesterday, when we were talking about the speeds, it was crawling at maybe 4 or 5 miles per hour. Now it's moving closer to 14 miles per hour. So it's going to have a bit of a quicker journey. It's going to get accelerated by a few different wind patterns as it ends up making its way further northeast. But there is still a continued risk of flooding. Even though we're not talking about yesterday's record-setting 185 mile per hour winds that we saw in Jamaica, we are still seeing plenty of areas where they're seeing downpours. Some parts of Cuba by the end of the day will have picked up anywhere from 18 to 24 inches. There continues to also be flash flooding throughout Haiti and the Dominican Republic. So we're definitely not out of the woods when it comes to the risk, but I want to take a look at what this storm has done so far to Jamaica. This is the reality on the ground. When we talk about things like 40 inches of rain or 15 feet of storm surge, it effectively turns entire streets like this into rivers. And this isn't yesterday. This was earlier today in Kingston, Jamaica. This isn't even the part of Jamaica that saw the storm's landfall. And so what we're talking about here is a situation where it's probably going to take weeks just to assess all the damage throughout the island of Jamaica. But we could see places uninhabitable for months, maybe even years. This long recovery effort just starting now.
John, you've got a reputation for calling it like you see it, leading to a couple of viral moments, first with Hurricane Milton last year and a similar moment yesterday with Melissa. I want to play those real fast.
It's just an incredible, incredible, incredible hurricane. It has dropped. It has dropped 50 millibars in 10 hours. I apologize. This is just horrific.
180, what's the pressure?
Pressure, this is Air Force flying into that.
Pressure. Yeah, this is Attenberg. He's giving me this
pressure
information.
Pressure is now down to 896.
Oh, my Jesus Christ. Okay. All right, I'm going to hold it together here.
John, that authenticity, that realness, that connects with people. What do you hope people in a hurricane's path take from your passion?
Well, listen, I mean, I've changed in recent years. I've been a meteorologist for over 40 years, the first years with NOAA and the National Weather Service, and then I pivoted to broadcast news. And throughout, I would say, the first 25 years of my broadcast career, I was known as the resident non-alarmist here in South Florida, a TV market, a media market, which has a reputation for being quite alarmist and leading with tropical systems, even though they're 3,000 miles away in their newscasts, right? I was always going against the grain. But the problem in recent years is that we're seeing the frequency and intensity of whether it's tropical cyclones or heat waves or flash floods or wildfires. All these extreme weather events fueled by climate change are increasing, and it's making me change. I've always been authentic, that's for sure, but I can no longer be non-alarmist. People need to realize that this is not going to stop until we cut down on the injection of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. And since that's not happening either anytime soon, because we haven't seen enough momentum in that area, that needs to change, of course. Therefore, we need to adapt to these more intense and frequent disasters.
In fact, I spoke with another scientist who's based in Jamaica just last hour, who said because of the strength and power of the storms that we're seeing getting bigger and stronger, we may need to, you know, have a Category 6. Like, these storms are off the charts. Melissa is off the charts. What do you think? Do we need to rethink how we predict, track, or even grade these extreme weather events?
Well, first and foremost, I mean, there is no practical difference between the impacts of a Category 4 and a Category 5 hurricane. They're both catastrophic. Just ask Puerto Rico and what they lived through with a Category 4 Hurricane Maria in the year 2017. So I expect what transpired yesterday in Jamaica to be very similar to what Puerto Rico lived through in 2017, even though Jamaica was a 5 and Puerto Rico was a 4. I don't think adding a category on top of 5 is going to make a difference in terms of what the impacts of these catastrophic systems are. Now, I will tell you that peer-reviewed science indicates that across the planet, a greater proportion of tropical storms that are forming are reaching these catastrophic Category 4 and 5 levels. It's not that we're getting more storms. It's not that we're getting more hurricanes or typhoons. It's just that a greater percentage of them are becoming these very destructive, devastating systems that, like the ones we saw yesterday.
John, hurricane hunters actually had to abort at least 2 missions into Melissa because the turbulence got so bad. They're working without pay right now during this shutdown. How has the shutdown piled on top of DOGE cuts? You know, how has it made the job even harder?
Well, I mean, I have knowledge from the former chief of the forecast branch of the National Hurricane Center, who responded to me on Blue Sky, on the Blue Sky app, confirming that they've had to bring back retired staff from the Atmospheric, Oceanographic, and Marine Laboratory, or AOML, within which the operations of the NOAA Hurricane Hunters sits. Previously, back in April, we had heard from the Director Emeritus of AOML, Dr. Robert Atlas, say that they were down 40% to 50% staff. And I'm wondering, as we go through hurricane season and we've seen all these storms out there, especially these extremely intense ones, which has been a characteristic of this year, how is it that these hurricane hunters have been able to continue to fly? Well, now we have our answer, right? It turns out they've brought back retirees to be able to staff the mission, which is so crucial and so critical to be able to, well, better forecast, better monitor, better forecast, and therefore warn for saving lives and property.
Absolutely, about keeping people safe. John Morales, Moses Small, guys, thank you very much. Thanks for laying it all out for us.